Good morning, guys. I had a chance to put together a video yesterday of one of the trapped Yoshis I'm working on for a wholesale drop. Nothing special. I've done this for you guys before. This is the first time I've done one with the Dididium lens that I got from, I think it's Diddy Clips is the Instagram he goes by. I felt like this really amped up this demonstration. You could probably see a lot more here than what you've probably seen in previous Yoshi demos. Don't worry, I'm still planning on doing, I have notes to do like a hammer demo, also doing a rig, and definitely shoot me a message for any other demos you'd like me to shoot. Right now what I'm doing is I'm building the mouthpiece. The color I'm using for this is light cobalt from North Star. Doesn't show any coil pot lines, so I can coil it out. Some colors I would do a solid color blowout for this. Most of this rig's already built, so I already have the vessel made, I have the Yoshi and the perk made. This is mainly just a demonstration of how I assemble everything. I did get a new tripod, which allowed me to get this new camera angle. It worked really well for most of it, but keep in mind there are some parts where I step out of frame. I'll try to summarize what's going on when that happens. Now, right now I'm using the Enqualo to blow this out, and then I'll use the Elmarver to flatten it back into a cylinder. Struggling a little bit with this one. Sometimes I'll get it just in that first movement, but I had some uneven spots on this section. So I actually go back and blow it out, condensed it several times before I was happy with it. So this is gonna take a moment. I pretty much kept all of the footage raw. I did cut out some sections where it just drug on, doing the same thing over and over. And also some areas where you just couldn't see what I was doing. And Enqualo helps me out a ton here. I've done all of this in the past by hand. Normally I would just spin it by hand on the Elmarver and use both of my hands to stabilize the blow tube. You can also do it on a tooling roller, and then you would just take like a paddle and set it underneath of the cylinder while you roll it back and forth. Works just as well. But not gonna lie, the Enqualo really speeds it up and helps me be a lot more consistent with the size and the thickness of these. Actually surprised that my Elmarver doesn't have like almost like an indention carved into it at this point. I've had this same one for I think 3.5 years now, and it doesn't really show any wear. So as long as you take care of them, they work for a long time. You'd also notice in this video I have my blast shield up. Mainly I just do that for heat. In the summertime especially, I'll have that up and it helps keep the heat off my face. Something small like this doesn't really make a difference, but later on when I'm working on bigger sections, it helps a lot. I also think it might help protect my eyes a little bit more. You know, I'm using shade 3 lenses, which are pretty strong, but having that extra layer of UV protection in front of me kind of adds a little bit more insurance. And as you can see, I'm still struggling with this, just trying to get it just right. I've bounced back and forth on these mouthpieces. In the past, I would use a 9.5 millimeter blow tube. I actually use those for pretty much everything I made. Now that things are getting bigger, I'm trying to add more stability. And also, I'm trying to make sure there's more airflow. You know, the smaller that hole, the less vapor can get through there. But at the same time, if the hole is too large, well then you're gonna have water coming through there. I try to position the Yoshi's nose in front of the hole, so it does block the majority of the water, but they don't always line up perfectly, and even a small gap sometimes can still let water through if the mouthpiece isn't the right size. Yeah, I'm getting ready to pop a hole here now. Starting a new process with these mouthpieces, so I kind of juggle them back and forth. So first I do the coil pot, make the cylinder as you just saw me do. Now I'm popping a hole. This side here is going to be the side that your mouth actually goes on. So the next blow tube that I connect, it's going to be the final blow tube, the one that I use until the piece is finished. I try to make sure that one's a little bit longer, because then it will accommodate the two bends that I have to put in it to get the axis back on center. And in this part here, I used my magic mini jacks to open up the hole, and now I'm going back and forth between the L marver and using my extra paddle there to push the whip in. Basically, I'm trying to thicken that up, and then going back with my pencil reamer to open it back up so it doesn't get too small. And sometimes I go back and forth there until I'm happy with it. Ideally, I want the thickness of that to match the thickness of the clear vessel, and those are usually 5 millimeters thick. Now I'm going to prep a blow tube that I'll attach to that side. And again, this is gonna be the final handle. This one was a little short. Usually I'd want it to be probably about 18 inches long, because the bends that we're gonna be putting in this, it probably subtracts 5 or 6 inches from the tube. There's a lot of different ways you can open up a blow tube. This is probably one of my most preferred methods. I just pull a peak and then I'll go back in and throw a hot gather over the top of it. This is a technique I think I learned from Mike Mason on Torch Talk. It's what I use to open up a lot of different holes. So if I'm trying to open up like a bubble cap, carb cap, perk holes, like here, blow tube, it's a very versatile technique. The only thing you need to be worried about is where those shards of glass go after you snap that peak off. So you'll notice I'm always holding the tube downward so they fall out. And then also if I'm in a situation like a perk where I have air pressure, I'll actually puff as I push down onto the peak and snap. Then what'll happen is the air pressure will blow those shards of glass out, so that way they don't get inside of the vessel or perk that I'm working on. Now I'm just going back and grabbing that mouthpiece that I made earlier out of the kiln, and I'm getting ready to attach it to that blow tube I just prepped. Putting a earplug in the original handle, and then putting my blow hose connection onto where it's gonna be the new and final handle. I am going to leave some of the clear on the other end. That's something I've recently started doing. Basically, I've had an issue where I'm trying to weld the color mouthpiece to the clear vessel, and getting a nice clean weld there, it's a struggle sometimes. So now I've started doing it this way, where I'll put a small section of clear, and then that away the weld that I'm putting there is between two clear sections. Only done it a few times. This one, the clear is a little longer than I probably would have preferred. Also, if you saw there, I really worked that weld in smooth. I want to make sure I've got a nice hot seal. I'm relying on the fact that the color is going to move a lot stiffer than the clear. So at the end, when it comes time to detach this blow tube, I'm going to be able to tear off all of the clear and not distort the line where the blue mouthpiece ends, because the clear is going to liquefy at a much lower heat than the color will. Now you'll see that small section of clear I left on there. I popped that open, added a bridge anchor on there as well. And now it's all ready to throw onto the vessel. Just getting my flame where I want it to be before I grab this pieces out of the kiln. Every minute counts when you're out of the kiln. So trying to prepare the area, have everything ready where it needs to be before you grab everything out, that's gonna help you save time. Just wiping both of those off on one of my Kevlar sleeves, trying to make sure I don't have much kiln dust on them. I do have a mat in my kiln that helps lower the dust, but you still get it over time, mainly from the doors and the sidewalls. So you just have to make sure you keep everything nice and clean before you hit it with the flame. Otherwise, what would happen is that kiln dust would actually get baked into the glass permanently, and then the piece would basically be ruined. If you see here, I'm focusing most of the heat on the color, or on the mouthpiece, I should say, because it does have that clear section, but that's where I put most of the heat at there. Sorry, this part's out of frame. Basically, once I stuck that on there, I pulled and puffed at the same time. The mouthpiece blow tube has an earplug in it, and then my blow hose is connected to the bottom one. I do it that way just because it's more centered. Right now, I'm going to bridge the vessel to this new blow tube and the mouthpiece connection. I'm using that stub of an anchor that I put on there, and I'm bending that down to connect to a matching stub that I've welded to the colored dots on the top of the vessel. I used to bridge these to the bottom. That means I had like a 5 or 6 inch bridge on every single trapped Yoshi. Now that I've started adding these colored dots on there, it gives me a solid point of attachment. So now I only have to do, you know, a 2 or 3 inch long bridge. I'm not really concerned about the extra glass, but the having that bridge closer to where that weld is at does two things. One, the weld's gonna stay hotter longer because it's closer to where the flame's at. And two, it's gonna be a lot faster for me to get that bridge welded cleanly and go back to working on that mouthpiece weld. What's happened in the past many times is it takes so long to get the bridges all set up correctly that by the time I go back to hit the mouthpiece with my mini torch, it actually cracks off of the vessel. Now, this is one part of the demo that unfortunately did mostly get cut out of frame. Basically, what I'm doing right now is I'm reworking that weld with my mini torch. The first stick that I did on the bench torch, that was probably only 50% welded in. Now I have to go back over it with the mini torch and work that in to basically a point where you can barely see it. There's basically gonna be a very faint line where those two clear sections meet, but that's it. Other than that, it should be a smooth weld. And I'm using gravity a lot here. So whatever direction I need the glass to move. For example, if the glass on the mouthpiece is thicker than the glass on the vessel, well then I'll hold it with the vessel down. That'll allow the glass to flow towards it. I really wish I would have got this part on, but unfortunately this portion was taking quite a while. I even cut out quite a bit of it. I was struggling to get that weld and I got lucky with that one. Honestly, if it wouldn't have had that clear section in there, I probably would have had to scrap this. But because I had that section of clear in between the mouthpiece and the vessel, I was really able to work that in. I almost had to reshape it a little bit with the mini torch and my blow hose to get it to look right. Otherwise, it was a little crooked before. But now I'm happy with it. So the next step here is probably one of the most important steps for getting a perk up through the bottom. It's having your blow tube on center. If this is off center even a little bit, it's really gonna affect the closing of the bottom and how flat of a bottom that I can get on it. A lot of times what's happened in the past is I'll think it's centered, but it's not fully centered, it's not perfect. When I finish the rig, you're really happy, it looks super clean, and then you set it on a counter and you kneel down in front of it, and you'll notice there might be a little tilt one direction or the other. And that's usually because the blow tube wasn't centered. And that's probably one of the most frustrating things that can happen because, you know, in my eyes, it reduces the value of the piece at that point. And if you notice there, I'm doing two bends. The first bend, I'm going straight across, trying to stay centered with it. And then I did a second bend where I bring it back towards my hand. I call it like an S bend. It's pretty much the bend that you're gonna use anytime you need to get an offset punt to your blow tube handle. Now, what I do next is I go back and forth with a heavy propane flame that will move that tubing just a little bit. And I'm gonna go back to the tooling roller, and then I'll go back to the flame, make an adjustment. And if you notice there, I'm using a long blow tube to match up the bottom tube that I know is on center with this new top handle. And I kind of use that as a way to measure where I'm at. And sometimes this will go together really quick. You know, I'll do those bends, I'll make a slight adjustment, and it'll be perfect. And then sometimes I'll fight it for 10, 15 minutes, just working back and forth, trying to get it on center. Wanna say this one did take me quite a while. I cut some of it out just so you guys didn't have to sit there and watch all of the adjustments. But that's kind of the gist of it. If you notice the way that I bent the tubing there, normally I'll use the flame you see here. This is just like a really heavy propane annealing flame with a little bit of oxygen added in. Basically, the slower you can bend it, the better. If you try to bend it really fast, that means that you've gotten the glass very hot, which means, you know, trying to keep it from kinking is gonna be a lot harder. But if you get it like a really soft, cool, warm orange, then when you go to bend it, it usually won't lose that shape. It'll still stay nice and round. Still just working this handle, trying to get it centered as I can. This is one of the benefits of doing a hot seal on that mouthpiece. In the past, when I would do a cold seal, you really didn't have a lot of time to mess with this top handle to get it centered. Basically, what would happen is after so long, that cold seal would break off. And so by putting on a hot seal there, I give myself a lot more time to work with it. It's like there, I was able to get it as centered as I could. Was pretty happy with that. Took off that bottom handle. So now it's all prepped up for the Yoshi. Always good to have more room on the bottom there than not enough. If you get too close to where the perk or the downstem hole's at, it's gonna be difficult keeping the Yoshi centered in position. And this one turned out pretty clean. Now I've got it back on the end quality after being in the kiln for probably about 5 minutes there. Tearing open the bottom, and I'll flare this out. This is one of those steps where the end quality has really made a big difference for me. In the past, what I would have done is I would have put it on the tooling roller and I'd be using that for this step instead. This is just a little bit faster, a little less wear and tear on my arm. Sometimes I tear these open. I just use like a 4mm punty and a sharp flame and I can tear the hole open. Sometimes I'll hook up a blow hose and pop the hole. It really doesn't matter. Either way, it's gonna work fine. This whole section I'm working on right now, that's gonna be torn off at the end. So even if there's some tool marks or it's a little wonky at that hole opening, it's not gonna be there at the final product. When it comes to opening the bottom of the vessels, I've used all sorts of different tools. I like to use graphite sometimes, like I'm doing now, because then I can keep it in the flame. That's probably a little faster method. More cleaner method though is what I'm doing now. I'm busting out these jacks. Really wish I had a nicer set though, because when I was out at Revere Studio last month, I was able to use some of his Italian shears, and man, they made a big difference. They had a lot more rigidity to them. The ones I have are just some $50, $60 ones, so they get a little wobbly, but they do the trick. Important part is just to warm them up first, get a good layer of beeswax on them before I go into the vessel. And I'll wax them several times in between each flare, just to make sure. Whenever you're using beeswax, the important thing to remember is to hold the vessel at a downward angle. That way any excess wax will fall out. You don't want that beeswax to fall inside of your vessel, sometimes what'll happen is it'll create almost like a weird looking fume inside of it. Once that happens, it's ruined. It's really difficult to get that back out. Now I'm getting the Yoshi perk prepped. First step I do is I remove the bridge that's holding it onto the perk or downstem. This top weld on the head of the Yoshi, it is a hot weld or a hot seal, just for extra insurance. So now what I need to do is I have to go through and tear out all of the clear. I'm mainly focusing the heat on the back of the head, so I don't want to boil the white on the eyes. Just using my tweezers to pull out as much of the clear as I can. You could use a punty for this or a variety of other tools as well, whatever you like to use to remove small amounts of glass. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going back into it with my mini torch. Just because this baby blue I'm using, it's from Borobars. It's a heat sensitive color, so it could boil on me. Whenever I'm dealing with a small peak of a heat sensitive color in a situation like this, I like to use my mini torch because I have a little bit more control and I can get a softer flame. Also, it's easier for me to shape it. I want to make sure I get a nice round top. And then I go back in with my carving knife and I bring back the line that's between the eyes further back. Something I've started doing probably just in the last few months. I think it really helps complete that look on the eyes of the Yoshi. Next step here is to basically trim this downstem to the length that I want it to be. I've seen some other artists that actually cut these with a saw, something I've been thinking of doing myself. Right now though, I just tear these off. And this will be very similar to what you saw me do when I opened up the blow tube earlier. I'm going to pull a peak and do a cold snap to open it. The trickiest part here is just making sure that that peak is perfectly on-centered. So if you look, I'm changing the angle and making sure that no matter which direction you look at it, the peak is in the middle. And then right at the length that I want it to be as well. Always better to go too long here because I can always go back and shorten that up. And I'm just getting ready to do the cold snap. You notice I'm not bringing the hot gather on top of the peak. I actually hold that steady and then I bring the Yoshi down on top of it. Snapped it open. Holding it downward just to make sure that none of those shards of glass get stuck in there. And now I'm just using my graphite pencil reamer to open that up. I don't want a flare. I want it to be a nice straight opening. So this is another thing where, again, I'm looking at from both sides, making sure that not one side is further in than the other. If it is, I'll heat that side only. And then I'll use my graphite reamer to kind of pull it out. And now that it's trimmed up, I'm just reheating the entire thing, making sure it's nice and warm and happy before I go back into the kiln with it. Now I'm cleaning up the vessel. It's going into the Enquala. I'll have the Enquala hold it in position for me while I insert the perk. Before I had this, I would just hold the vessel in my left hand, the perk in my right hand, and then I'd use my bench torch to insert them. Ever since I got the Enquala, I've done it this way because it gives me a lot more precision. I use my mini torch to actually tag the perk to the inside wall. That way I can get it exactly where I want it to be and make sure that it's centered with the mouthpiece. And these are a really snug fit. I try to get them as close to the walls as I can. Now what I'm doing is I'm just heating the spot where the downstem's gonna attach to the inside wall. As I heat this, I'm going to pull up. So I'm basically pushing that downstep into that wall, trying to create a nice weld. It's not a complete weld yet, but the better I can get it on this first attempt, the less chance I'm gonna have of this vessel cracking on me. when I'm getting it bridged into place and then going back in and fully melting it in. And this is the time that I have to adjust the Yoshi. You know, if it needs to move left, right, or up, or down, this is the time that I have to do that. So you'll see I kind of went back into that weld, and I'm looking at it from all directions, trying to make sure it's centered and isn't tilted one direction or the other. After I make the adjustment, I have to go back to the hole again and reheat that weld again, just to make sure it stays hot and happy when I go to do the bridge weld. The bridge weld on these takes a little bit because I'm using a 7mm versus a 4mm punty. I do that for a reason though, because the 7mm has a lot more rigidity to it. So once I get this bridge locked into place and go back up to this downstem weld, the Yoshi's not gonna move at all. So the first step is just getting that bend. And then now I'm gonna try to weld it to the bottom of this flare, heating it on all sides. This weld needs to be very clean. You can't have any hard edges here. Otherwise what will happen is a crack will start there and it'll spread up the whole vessel. After I get that weld in place, I go back to the downstem and there's no hole here yet. But what I'm doing is I'm reheating the whole ring. There's basically, it's a ring that you'll see from the downstem tagging to the inside wall. You'll see that I'm moving the mini torch in a circular motion. I'm following that ring and I'm trying to get it welded as nice as I can before I go to close up the bottom. In the past, I would have actually pulled that hole open and did like a cold peak snap on it. Nowadays though, I actually just get it welded really well and then I close up the bottom and then I can use air pressure to blow out that hole. So now I'm just reheating everything, making sure it's nice and hot before I go back in and remove that bridge and close up the bottom. And this is a step where in the past I would have actually gone into the kiln and then taken it back out after 5 to 10 minutes. Having the Enquala and the Bunsen burner, it allows me to stay out of the kiln and keep working on it. So now I'm going to remove the bridge before I go to close up the bottom of the vessel. You don't have to remove it, you could leave it on there. But I found it's a little bit more difficult to close up the bottom evenly and get like a nice even thickness base on it. What'll happen is the side that has the bridge will get like a thick spot on it from that 7mm welding to it. So by removing it beforehand, I prevent that from happening. And this is where having that excess glass pays off, because this step here, that Yoshi is no longer bridged. So the only thing holding it in place is where it's welded to the inside wall of the vessel. Well, if my bench flame gets too close, if it gets too hot, the Yoshi is going to start to move around in there because it doesn't have enough support. By giving myself an extra 1 to 2 inches on the bottom, I can close it up without getting that Yoshi weld too hot, so it will stay in place for me. If it does move around though, it's not the end of the world. I can what I'll do normally is if it moves, I'll get the bottom closed up and happy, and then later on, I'll be able to go back with a sharp flame and I'll heat both spots. I'll heat the base or the bottom where the bottom of the perk welds to the rig, and then I'll also heat up where that downstem hole is going to be. And then I can use gravity to move the Yoshi around to get him to fall into the perfect center that I want him to be at. Ideally though, I don't have to do that. And I can just get him centered on the first try, close up the bottom without moving him around, and then I don't have to worry about it. So if you saw there, I closed up the bottom. Now I'm just removing the excess glass, trying to create a nice even wall thickness down there. You don't want this to be too thick, but you don't want it to be too thin either. So it's kind of a balancing act you learn over time. This is where the Bunsen really helps out a lot, because I can take my time. I don't have to worry about anything cracking. Well, I can focus on that bottom and try to make sure I get it as even as I can. And this can take a while sometimes. For me, this is probably one of the more important steps of the process. You know, like I said earlier, if you finish out a vessel and it's crooked, it really, really sucks. So I try to take as much time as I can to make sure that that bottom is as flat as possible. If it is not, or if I get any detrification or anything on the bottom, my go-to then is to put it on my lap wheel, and then I can grind it flat, and then I'll go to my sandblaster, and then it'll erase any detrification or any weird spots that I have down there. Ideally though, I like to get a nice perfect bottom that doesn't require any cold working, and then from there, I can choose if I want to cold work it or not. I'm not forced to do it. If you saw there, I used my Lynx hand torch to heat up where the bottom bridge attaches to the bottom of the vessel. Basically what happens there is that section is thicker because you have, you know, a 7mm bridge stub meeting the bottom of the vessel. So it's a lot thicker glass. It takes a lot more heat to melt that in. If you don't do this step, what'll happen is the middle won't be flat. It'll stick out further. So by going in and heating that section where that weld meets the bottom, you can make sure that that's melted in first and then go back to the edges of the base. So then you won't get that high spot in there. And this one took me a bit, you know, like anything. Sometimes it'll go really fast and easy. Sometimes it might take you a while. It's just taking your time, being patient, not rushing yourself, and don't make concessions. You know, if you see something that you're not quite happy with, keep working it until you are happy with it. Because if you don't, I guarantee you when the rig's finished, you're not gonna be happy. You're gonna see that spot and be like, man, why didn't I take those extra 5 minutes to fix that? Something I'm still learning today though. You know, sometimes I rush myself or it gets to the end of the day and I'm like, screw it, you know, it'll be fine. I'll finish it up. And then I do, and the next day I pull it out of the kiln and I kick myself and say, man, why didn't you just take the extra time and fix it? So just learning to be patient, that's a big deal, especially for me, because I'm not a patient person. Glass has kind of taught me how to be patient, and it's something I'm trying to focus on every day. Now I've got the bottom where I want it to be, and I'm going in to pop the hole for the downstep. This is where having air pressure before I pop this hole really pays off. Where the downstem meets the inside wall of the vessel, there's basically two welds. There's the weld on the outside of the blow tube, and then there's the weld on the inside where the hole's actually gonna be popped. What I'm doing right now is I first went around the outside and welded it in and puffed it out and condensed it back down so I know that the outer ring weld is nice and happy. And then I go to the inside and I blow out a dome and do another cold snap. This is important though, I will flip it so that way when I do the cold snap and I blow at the same time, any extra shards of glass will come out of the vessel. And this is all being done with my hand torch and Bunsen. I know the angle on this, sometimes it looks like it's being hit by the bench torch. But no, it's probably about 5 or 6 inches back from the bench torch. I'm doing all of this with just my Little Smith mini torch. Now that the hole's opened up, I'm just finishing cleaning it up with my pencil reamer. Ideally, I get it to the right diameter off of the first peak snap. I don't want to have to adjust this hole very much. I just want to be able to do a small touch up on it. If I have to stretch this hole open really far, you know, if I don't blow that dome big enough before I snap it open, then I have to stretch it open with like a reamer And sometimes it'll leave tool marks or it'll leave stress marks in the glass there. So something I've been focusing on lately is trying to make sure that all of my holes are the right size before I pop them open. So then I don't have to really do much adjustment to them besides just a quick cleanup with a pencil reamer. Now the hole is popped open. I was happy with how it looked after reaming it. I'm just reheating the entire vessel and then I'm gonna throw it back into the kiln. Technically, I could probably leave it out like this and just keep running it over the Bunsen and an annealing flame with my bench torch and then just go straight to the joint attachment. I like to play it safe though, so I will actually stick it back into the kiln, usually for about 10 minutes just to make sure it's nice and hot, and then I bring it back out to do the joint attachment. For the joint attachment, I like to use a 4mm punty connected to a 10mm male joint plug. That's basically going to be my handle to attach it. And then it's also going to be what eventually becomes the bridge to hold the joint in place while I finish cleaning up the weld. I'm focusing most of the heat on the color, just because the blue, it takes a lot more heat than the clear does to get it melting. And then it's hard to see here, but basically what I do is I just try to take one of the edges and get it in the right spot, and then I roll it over the top of the downstem hole. And then I can try to pull out a little bit and adjust it. You know, sometimes I might have to pull it a little bit further out or a little left or right. You do have a few seconds there to move it around before it fully solidifies. Now I'm going back and bridging it to that top 7mm bridge that I already had before. And then I've got to go in and clean up the weld. Typically, anytime I do a joint weld, I'll also have my TI ready to go too. Sometimes what'll happen is when I roll it over the hole, there might be a gap left over. And that's what happened here. So you can see I'm grabbing my TI pick and there was a spot where the blue didn't meet the clear. So there's basically a hole there. I'm gonna use my mini torch and the TI pick to knit that together. It's hard to see. Basically all I'm doing though is I'm putting all the heat into that section of blue that isn't meeting the clear. Once I get that nice and hot, I go back in with the TI pick and I pull it down so that it meets the clear. And now I'm just going all the way around, making sure that it's fully welded in on all sides. You'll see I alternate between puffing and using the TI pick. Really want to make sure this is a nice, clean, happy weld. This is where it's going to crack, if it will. If it's going to crack, this is where it's going to happen. Because this is probably the most stressful weld on the entire rig. Just because, you know, you've got the downstem connected to the inside wall. Now you're sandwiching another piece of color glass over the top of that. So this spot's pretty thick. One issue I had one in the past is I had a pinhole. You know, I thought I had the weld all the way around. The next day I'm like, man, this rig's so clean. I'm so happy with it. I put water in it, tested it. It worked great. A couple hours later, I looked over on the shelf it was sitting on. There's a puddle of water underneath of it. I couldn't figure out why. I looked at it closely underneath of my lights and I noticed there was just a pin size hole. Went to try and go and fix it that day and I broke the entire rig. So sometimes it's the hard lessons that really teach you things, because after that, I don't think I've ever had that happen again, because I double if not triple check my weld here just to make sure all the way around it's nice and happy. Probably one of the most difficult parts of these welds on this rig is the upper part of it. So not the bottom or the sides, but that part that's in between the vessel and the joint. It's a really narrow space. That's why you'll notice on all of my joints, I blow a bubble on the bottom. That bubble is to give me that clearance. Because if you look at the top, the lip of the joint sticks out, you know, 3-4 millimeters from the actual joint itself. So I have to replicate that on the bottom in order to give myself enough room to be able to weld the top of that joint. Just went ahead and double checked to make sure my base was flat and didn't have any wobble. It didn't. And I just reheated the whole thing before I threw it back into the kiln. Had it in there for probably close to another 10 minutes. And now I'm ready to take it all apart and get it off the blow tube. This is a little bit new process for me, just because again, this is a new style of bridge compared to what I've done in the past. I think this is probably the third or fourth one I've done this way. So the first thing I do is I take out the joint plug. And now the second step is to remove the bridge from that colored dot. And this part's the trickiest part, I'd say, about this new bridge, is trying to get the flame in there to cut out this bridge that's connected to that color dot without hitting the vessel itself. You know, I don't want this bench flame to touch the vessel or mouthpiece because it could cause it to crack or it could distort the shape. So I'm just trying to focus on where that color meets that color dot. And just taking a little bit off at a time here, because it's better to take a little bit at a time than to take too much. Because if I take too much, I might rip more of the color dot off than I want, or I might even potentially, you know, start pulling the vessel. Once I get most of the clear off, I go back in with my mini torch to re-round it, because it gets a little bit of a peak on it from tearing that off. Once I get it rounded, I grab my finishing tongs, and now I'm gonna rip off the blow tube and work on the mouthpiece. I'm heating probably just a centimeter or two back from the actual mouthpiece, so I'm trying to leave a little bit of clear on there. Because basically what we're doing here is almost the same thing you saw before. When I opened up the perk, I had to pull that peak, do a cold snap, trying to do the same thing with the mouthpiece. Again though, the difference here is I have that separation between the clear and the color, and that helps me because when I go to tear off the clear, it takes less heat than the color. So that way I still keep a nice line there. So just focusing on the remaining clear, pulling that into a peak. I'm going to try to make sure it's nice and centered. That looks pretty good. So now I'm going to do the cold snap using, it's like a 4 millimeter here. I go back and forth between 4 millimeter and 7 millimeter, just depending on how big the hole needs to be and how much I want to ream it after the fact. Letting it cool for a second, and then it snaps right off. Looks like I got all the clear I wanted. Hole's pretty even already. Just need to top it off with the pencil reamer to make sure it's nice and perfectly round. The less work you have to do right now, the better, because I want to keep the shape there as close to the original as possible. And that's it. Pretty nice mouthpiece. And notice there the clear is a little bit longer than I originally intended, but otherwise I was super happy with this one. And you'll notice the size of it, it's a lot closer to what my original Yoshis were. Really been trying to focus on shrinking these back down. They were getting pretty big there for a while. But that's the demo. I just want to thank you guys so much for all of your support. I know the content's been lacking lately on the Close Friend Story, and I haven't had a chance to upload very many demos onto the actual Patron page. Still just trying to get caught up and ahead of things. It just feels like I take one step forward and two steps back. I still have notes on what you guys were requesting me to demo for you, so I think the next demo I'm hoping to shoot is going to be the hammer demo. Hoping to get that one done here in the next week for you. And then I am still working on the sub packs. I did misnote that. Those sub packs actually are supposed to be going out August 1st. I'm trying to do them on the first of each month. So there will be one August 1st, and then the next one will be October 1st. I think you guys are going to be pretty excited about what I'm making for you. It's something I've had a lot of requests for in the past, but I've never actually done that for anyone else. So again, thank you so much for your support. I hope you guys enjoyed this and hope you have a great day.